Welcome everyone to this first online lecture. Today we will talk about stochastic dependence. We will talk about how to model dependence between random variables using coupleless, and we will talk about how to measure dependence using correlation coefficients. So far, we focused only on one-dimensional random variables x. So we assumed that we are exposed to a loss x, and if you wanted to determine a expectation or a variance or maybe a stop loss premium, what we need is the CDF of this random variable. In this lecture, we will change the setting a bit. We will assume that we are exposed to multiple risks at the same time. So we are now looking at the random variables x1, x2, xn, each representing one of the risks we are exposed to. So for each risk separately, we can use a CDF to describe the different probabilities. But our problem now has to be modeled using a random vector. So each xi in this random vector is called a marginal. So the x1, x2, and xn are the marginals of our problem. And studying the marginals will tell you what happens with the different risks separately. But what we are interested in is what happens with the risks simultaneously. So for example, assume that you have two risks, x1, x2, and you're looking at the random vector x1, x2. So we can use the marginal CDF fx1 to investigate or to determine, for example, the probability that your first loss x1 will be very big. And we can use the marginal CDF of risk x2 to determine the probability that your second risk will take a very big loss. However, what we are interested in is not these separate probabilities. We are interested in the probability that risk x1 is large and risk x2 is large at the same time. So what we want to determine for our random vector is the joint CDF. Is this probability that describes what happens in x1, x2 until xn simultaneously. So if you know the joint CDF of your random vector, you can use this formula to back out the marginal CDFs. So the joint CDF contains information about the marginal CDFs. However, you cannot go in the opposite way. If you know all your marginal CDFs, you still have not enough information to determine your joint CDF. So remember that your marginal CDFs, they tell you how the risks x1, x2, xn are behaving individually. So the missing piece to construct your joint CDF is the information about the dependence. It's the information on how these marginals are moving together. So if you want to determine the joint CDF of a random vector, you have to model the marginal distributions and the dependence. And if you want to model dependence, you have to use coupleless. So coupleless are the essential tool to model the dependence between your marginals. So if you use the coupleless, you can model the joint CDF of your random vector in two separate steps. So in step one, you look only at your marginals. So you look only at the data you have, for example, for risk x1. You use that part of the data to determine your distribution function of x1. And then you use the data of x2 to determine the distribution function of your risk x2. And you continue like this, step by step, to move from x1 to x2 until xn. So at the end, you have all your marginal distributions. And then you go to step two of your algorithm, where you model the dependence. So then you determine how do these different marginals move together by specifying the correct coupleless. Before we move to the theory on coupleless, let me introduce you to a simple example to illustrate the importance of coupleless. So assume you have two risks, x1, x2, and x1 and x2 denote the returns of two different stocks. So you have stock 1, stock 2, x1, x2, and you look at, for example, returns. So I can use the data of x1 to determine the empirical distribution of my returns of stock 1, and I do the same for stock 2. And then I measure the strength of the dependence, how they move together, by using the Pearson correlation or the rank correlation Kendall-Stau. And here we have situation A. We have a marginal distribution for x1. We have a marginal distribution for x2. We have a Pearson correlation of 0.7. And the other measure, Kendall-Stau, is 0.5. So A is one possible situation for my two stocks. Another situation could have been situation B. And what you see here is that the marginal distributions in situation A and B are very similar. So x1 and x2 have more or less the same marginal distributions in the two situations. But if you look at the correlation coefficients here, it's minus 0.7 and minus 0.5. And you also see in the scatter plots that the dependence structure in both cases is very different. So this example shows that only looking at marginal distributions is not a good approach, because my dependence structure can be very different and the marginal distributions can be the same. In this situation, the correlation coefficients are able to detect this difference. So if you only look at the marginal distributions, you don't see any difference between situation A and situation B. But if you add the correlation coefficients, rho and RK, you see a clear difference. So let's look at two other situations for our two stocks, X1, X2. So here we have situation C. Again, the marginal distribution, if you compare to, for example, situation A, the marginal distribution of X1, X2 are the same for situation A, situation C. But here, if you look at the correlation rho, or Kendall-Stau RK, they're also the same. So if we have our data, situation A, situation C, they cannot be differentiated using marginal distributions or correlation coefficient, because the marginal distribution in both situations are more or less the same. The correlation coefficients are also more or less the same. However, if you look at the scatter plot here, it's a very different dependence than in the previous case. What you see here is that you have a stronger dependence here in the upper tail. And the same happens with situation D. If you compare situation B with situation D, you see that the marginal information, so the marginal distributions of X1 and X2, are more or less the same, and the correlation coefficients are also more or less the same. So you see that even if you add correlation coefficients, it's still possible that the dependence between your two situations is very different. So you need couplers to detect this difference, to model this difference in dependence structure. And here is a third situation where we have yet another dependence structure. So now you can compare situation A, C, and this new situation E. In the three situations, the marginal information is more or less the same. Correlation coefficients rho and RK are giving the same number, but the dependence structure in the three cases is very different. So therefore, we need Coppola functions to model these three different situations. And that's what we will try to do in this chapter.